Of all the sports that currently exist in American culture, there is perhaps none more spectacular, or at least intriguing, than NASCAR. Even if you don't understand the fascination with fast cars that primarily only make left-hand turns, you cannot deny their popularity. NASCAR has been the fastest growing sport in the world for almost a decade. Its fans are almost cult-like in their admiration for the cars, the drivers, even the owners. Richard Childress is one of those owners, and he is a god in the world of stock car racing. He has been the backbone for great driving teams featuring the likes of Kevin Harvick, Robbie Gordon, Ricky Rudd, and most notably, the great Dale Earnhardt. If you know NASCAR, you've heard of RCR Racing Enterprises. But what do you know about Richard Childress, the man? How did he get his start? How did the death of Dale Earnhardt impact the way he approaches racing today? What spurred his interest in hunting and raising Angus cattle? Today we'll learn more about the man who started down a country road and then later dominated the fastest pavement in the racing world. Like many of today's racing stars, Richard Childress grew up in the South. His father died when he was only 5 years old. It was a tragedy for young Richard, but such a loss can either ruin your life or it will make you stronger. For Childress, it was the latter. It was his stepfather that actually introduced him to the two things he loves most today, stock car racing and farming. He went to his first stock car race when he was only 8 or 9 years old. One Saturday night at the local track, and he was hooked. But it wasn't just the sound and speed of the race cars that intrigued him. His interest in business was also piqued as he watched the local kids making money selling peanuts and popcorn in the stands. Making money and being at the races, it was a match made in heaven. Richard sold peanuts until he was in his teens. That's when he knew that he belonged on the track and in the car instead of in the stands. Fortunately, he and his friends didn't have to shell out a lot of cash to get started.
We bought a car, I think, when we was 17, paid $20 for it. It was an old taxi cab, and went out and raced it. About 2 weeks later, we fixed it up, carried it over and raced it in a little local beginner's class, which was a claiming division. And I didn't get to drive the first week. You know, we had to split that because we didn't have much money then. So I got to race it, and when it came my time, I liked it so much. I said, man, I got to have a car I can race every week. I can't sit here and watch this. So we went and borrowed some money and bought another car and paid $40 for it and fixed it up where we had two cars that we could go race.
It's a long way from the local racetrack to the biggest stock car race in the country. But Childress made his first trip in 1965. No, he wasn't driving. But his vision for the future was certainly cast.
Then I went to Daytona in 1965 with a friend and helped him with his car, and his name was Wayne Smith. And I said, this is exactly what I want to do. I want to be a big-time racer. I want to come to Daytona and race. So they started a division in 69 called the Grand American Division where you could race at Daytona. And the whole time I was still racing the short tracks and dirt tracks. And so I went and borrowed the money on my house and built this race car to go to Daytona with and went down there and really ran good. I think we qualified eighth right outside of some great road racers, you know, Parnelli Jones and Lloyd Ruby and some names like that. So we started running that and started doing the tours.
Doing the tours in the mid to late 60s is a little different than NASCAR today. Instead of flying from city to city and living on huge custom-made buses, the main goal back then was survival and sending some money back home to the family.
I would be gone sometime a couple of months, and I'd just send my wife and daughter enough money back to keep everything going at home, and I'd keep racing, and that's how we did it.
For the next 15 years, Childress worked his way up the field into being one of the best drivers in the country. But as the years flew by, the winds of change started to impact the business of racing. Big money was entering the sport in the early 80s, and Childress realized that his best business move was placing someone else behind the wheel of the car that he owned. It was not an easy decision, but there was new talent out there waiting to shine, and he knew that he had something special with a hot young driver he would ultimately make history with. His name? Dale Earnhardt.
Well, it was the toughest thing I had to do was get out of the car because, like I said, I wasn't ready to quit driving. The opportunity came along, and for Dale to run 10 races for me in 81, and I needed the money, I could see where big money people was coming into the sport, like Harry Rainier and Jim Stacy and Rod Osterlund, these big money investors. And the opportunity came, and I took it. Then Dale we made a decision that he would go drive for Bud Moore and I would go back to driving, but the opportunity came along for me to put Ricky Rudd in the car in 1982 and 83. And the whole time, Dale and I had been friends even before that, before he drove for me. And we were in a hunting club, and we still would sit down there at nights in this hunting club and talk about how we wanted to get back together and race together again. And the opportunity came along in 84 with Wrangler Jeans to get back together, and we did. We won our first championship in 86, won our first race in 84, won races with Ricky Rudd. So, you know, we've been pretty successful with all the drivers we had, but most all of our success and everything that's been built here has been built on the success with Dale Earnhardt.
Richard Childress currently resides on a country estate outside of the appropriately named Welcome, North Carolina. Inside this small community is RCR Racing Enterprises. It is the home for current stars such as Robbie Gordon, Ron Hornaday, Johnny Sauter, Steve Park, and the man who is arguably the hottest driver in NASCAR today, Kevin Harvick. As I toured the facility, I was struck by the number of racing cars in the garage. 20 years ago, there may have been 4 cars in the stable. Today, there are over 50 for their 5 drivers.
What do you look for in a young driver? And maybe more specifically, what do you think makes a champion? Because I guess that's what you're looking for as a champion.
An example was a Mike Skinner who won the championship in our trucks and Kevin Harvick who won a championship in our cars. And I think Dale Earnhardt set the standard. Even myself, before that, I look back at drivers that I had a tremendous amount of respect for. Cale Yarborough, Curtis Turner, a lot of these people, and their driving style was hard, whatever it took to win, go to the front and win the race and never give up. And those last few laps, when it comes time to go, you just got to tighten the belts and go. And that's what I like to see in a driver, and that's what I've got in most of my drivers today.
Which brings us back to Dale Earnhardt. If you are a true NASCAR fan, you either loved or hated Dale Earnhardt as a driver. His nickname was the Intimidator, and he brought out the passion in everyone, whether you were on his side or not. But his racing success occurred primarily when he drove for Childress, and there was something about that partnership that made for a winning team.
I just think both of us came up the same way. His dad died when he was young, and when that happens, you have to sort of become your own man, and you got several roads in life you can take, and Dale and I chose the ones we took, and I think we had a lot of similarities together, and it was just a great experience working with him, and not only being a friend, but him being such a great race driver. And I could tell from the time that we ran those first 10 races that there was something special there.
Dale Earnhardt died when his car crashed on the last lap of the 2001 Daytona 500. His passing is still painful for Childress, and it has changed the way he looks at the business of racing.
When you lose a really good friend, you think about a lot of things, and you probably do things different today than you would be doing if your friends or parents or whoever you've lost would be there. You look back and say, man, I wish I could have done this different or that. And this is a different organization. Dale was someone that had been with me for going on 20 years, and we could call each other up if there was a problem and talk about it, and those are the things you miss.
How important was Dale Earnhardt to RCR Racing? To know for sure, all you have to do is visit Childress's latest project, the Richard Childress Racing Museum and Gift Shop. The brand new museum is a must-see for racing fans and is no doubt a mecca for the millions of people who still wear Dale Earnhardt on their t-shirts and trucks. As we roamed through the museum, which was once the racing garage for RCR, we noticed at least 10 of the black number 3 cars, each car representing a Winston Cup victory or some memory significant to Childress.
This is the Daytona 500 winning car in 98 with the Daytona 500 trophy.
Wow.
This will have all 6 of the Winston Cup trophies on this wall. Now you can see these cars have never been shown. Nobody's even seen them. I've got 39 of them total.
With the exception of the photos and other memorabilia, the Racing Museum still looks every bit the old garage that prepped all of those famous cars in years past. The floor is shiny and spotless. You could almost eat on it. Cars are lined up perfectly in rows like works of art.
This is the car in that Dale Jr. won the race in 2002 in Daytona for us. These are the 3 vehicles that we won our 3 championships with. The car that Dale won his last championship in 94 with, Mike Skinner's truck he won the championship in 95 with, and the AC Delco Monte Carlo that Kevin Harvick won his championship in 2001 with.
The Racing Museum is impressive, But as I viewed the new RCR Racing garage and headquarters down the road, it reminded me of how NASCAR has also grown and expanded over the last decade. I asked Childress how NASCAR has changed over the years and why.
Well, I think the biggest change is the technology that's came into it and all the national coverage. You know, we have national TV covering it every week, and the awareness of the sport, and you're under a microscope every minute today. So, and the technology and the cars and the sport itself has just, you know, we, like I said earlier, I think we got 14 engineers working here.
Wow. Is there too much racing now? I mean, you occasionally hear someone say, man, we're out there so much during the year. As an owner, is it too much or is it just right?
I don't think you ever get too much racing, but, you know, right now our season, I'd rather see us race 35 or 36 straight weekends and have 20 weekends off. Right. I mean, that would be my prefer, you know, where we could have a little different quality of life.
You could go hunting more or for a longer period of time that way.
Well, sure, off time would have to be in hunting season.
That's right. Did I mention that Richard Childress loves the outdoors? His interest in hunting and raising cattle may actually equal his love of racing at this point in his life.
Let's talk about hunting real quick. What's your attraction to hunting? What is it about it, you know, that makes you go out four times a year and to all parts of the world?
Well, I love the outdoors, and I always have, you know, ever since I was a kid and went squirrel hunting the first time. You know, just the heritage of hunting and the conservation. I'm involved as heavy as I can be in the conservation side of it. Our youth is our future in hunting, and, you know, our forefathers were hunters. I think it's a huge heritage that we need to keep going, and I love to go out and hunt and sit in the woods and sit on the side of a mountain, and if I don't take any game, just go out there and be able to enjoy the outdoors. And I love to go to Kansas and hunt whitetails. You know, I love to go to Montana and hunt, and, you know, all over the British Columbia. I travel a lot. I've been to Africa several times, so I just love to hunt.
When it comes to hunting, Childress has been willing to put his money where his mouth is. As we continued to meander through his racing museum, we suddenly took a turn into a whole other world, a wildlife museum, complete with lions, bears, and a host of other creatures from around the world. Artists and construction workers were putting the final touches on the museum as we took the tour.
Four of them, three of them's here, and the other one's around the corner. And then, they've done laid the plaques down. There's going to be plaques here saying what each one of these conservation groups do for their own area.
And let's not forget Richard Childress, the farmer. His new home in North Carolina looks more like a country estate in Napa Valley, as it is surrounded by stakes and young grape plants that represent his new investment in winemaking. His Yadkin Valley Angus farm is a true cattle operation, complete with stock pens and land on the floodplain that is covered by water at least twice every year. Childress takes his interest in Angus cattle so seriously that he has been willing to disperse his entire herd and start all over again for the sake of improving both his land and his Angus bloodlines.
You know, with a black car, you had to have black Angus cattle, so which I did visit some other breeds and look into them many years ago in the 80s when I was looking to get into the purebred stock, and we had feeder cattle before, and up until about 2 years ago, I ran quite a few head of cattle out in Garden City, Kansas, and in different places in Kansas just with feeder cattle. But I really enjoy it. It's a getaway. I just don't have the time today that I had 5 years ago or 3 years ago or a year ago to put the time into it. And I'm trying to build the cattle business back to where whenever I can slow down, that's the one thing I really enjoy, the farming and the cattle aspect of it. And that's what I want to do.
Farming, kind of like car racing, presents its own sort of tragedy sometimes, or loss. It could be loss of profit, could be whatever. And kind of like racing, due to no fault of your own. Do you find a connection between the two of those things?
Yeah, it'd kind of be like running along and you're getting ready to win the race and blowing a tire out or getting spun out by someone. Or in the farming world, you know, hit a drought, right, or a flood or something like that that could affect you, or, you know, whatever the year could be. You know, so many things are out of your control in the farming and racing that depends on the success you have that year with your operation.
But for now, Richard Childress is still mostly about racing. And it's the fans that make NASCAR what it is today. They are faithful to their cars, their drivers, and their owners. They are also a patriotic bunch that does not hesitate to place their racing caps over their hearts when the Star-Spangled Banner is played. Indeed, patriotism and NASCAR seem to go hand in hand.
Well, I think this is grassroots Americans here, and there's so many race fans that believe in our country and believe in our leaders that believe in what our armed forces do for us. You know, I was fortunate enough to go to Bosnia and Germany and Spain and Italy in January to visit the troops and do sort of one of the USO-type tours where we got to meet and sign autographs with them. And to be able to go over there and see what the servicemen and women do for our country today, I think so many of us take it for granted how big that force is that it takes to look over a great country like America. And I think the race fans, so many of them, realize it and appreciate what our armed forces do for us.
You've won Daytona 500s. You've won many NASCAR championships, many Winston Cup championships, the Truck Series, the Busch Series. You've done it all. Why do you stay in it at this point?
Still, I have that burning desire to win. The day that I see that we can't win, that'll be the day I go to my cattle business. The way we're running it, it may be sooner than later in these cup cars. But, no, I just the sheer desire to win and the competitiveness in me. And, you know, you don't want to walk away from any day not knowing that you haven't given it your all.